All right. It is 7 o'clock Eastern time. Welcome. Thank you for joining us for USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 62. I'm Andrew Bartman, the Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. And hey, I appreciate you spending time with us here tonight. We have a small intimate gathering as our registration system had some issues this week. You may have noticed it, may have tried to find the event, couldn't find it. Then it would pop on for a day or so, then it'd come back off. But hey, thanks for maintaining, getting signed up. And to all of our friends watching on Facebook, thank you for joining us as well tonight. We've got a great lineup. We've got Adam Rosales with the Oakland A's. We have got Andrew DeVino, catching coach at Lakeland High School down in Florida, and Derek Johnson, big league pitching coach for the Reds and director of pitching for the Cincinnati Reds. So great lineup for you to get better with tonight. And thank you again for joining us. As a quick reminder, some ground rules. We need questions for the Q&A. We've got three presenters tonight. So we're going to go Q&A after every single presenter. So when something pops in your head, Coach Rosales is talking about something you want to know more about, pop it into the Q&A button down at the bottom. I'm dragging my mouse over in case you can see me doing that. Pop it in the Q&A button down at the bottom. And also, join us on the chat. Rich Moretta, friend of the program, already did. Let us know who you are, where you're from. Click that blue button. It says all panelists. Make it say all panelists and attendees so everyone can see it, not just myself and Adam here. Let us know who you are, where you're from, what level you coach, what team you coach. Drop a social handle in there and an email if you want to connect with anybody else. You can also direct message other attendees that are on here as well or myself. I will do the same. If I can do anything for you on USA Baseball's end, please let me know. You'll have my email, my cell phone, my Twitter handle, my Instagram handle. You can DM me, email me, call me, text me, whatever you want. I'm here for you. I'm here to serve you. That's what USA Baseball does. We want to serve the greater baseball community. For example, Brian C. down in Ocala, Florida, said, hey, I want to host an in-person community clinic. We can do it outdoors in Florida. Great. I'm going down there February 19th. We're going to have a great coaches clinic for Ocala Little League. You don't have to be a little league. You don't have to be a high school. You don't have to be a college. Anyone can host. We just got to make the dates and the times work up. And we are going to be looking for additional hosts for these. And you'll have USA Baseball come to you in person and bring you a tremendous coaches clinic. So we also are working with various major league and minor league clubs. Don't be surprised to see some of those popping up. We've already got dates locked in with the Baltimore Orioles to be in the stadium there, Camden Yards. I think that's what it's still called. We're going to be doing something with the Cubs up in Chicago. We're going to be doing something with the Reds. We're going to be doing something with the Pirates. We're going to be doing something with, man, there's a lot of clubs. We're going to be having coaches clinics free of charge in big league stadiums and minor league stadiums. So hopefully you look for those. And again, what I really want you to do, if you enjoy the content here, you enjoy what we have on usabdevelops.com, which mobile coach app, it's all free. Mobile coach app, the clinics, coaching certification, background checks, all that. Check it out. Spread the word. We love to talk to leagues. We love to talk to those people that have access to multiple coaches. We love what we do, and we feel like we have a lot of tremendous, tremendous information to share. So USAB Develops, plural with an S on the end, develops.com. You got a ton of great info at your fingertips. High school baseball coaches manual, youth baseball coaches manual. There's a lot of great info there. And also here with our virtual community coaches clinic. Again, we're staying with the virtual for all of us, all of you who can't bring us to you or you can't meet us the day that we're in your area. That's fine. You can keep coming back here 1 to 2 times a month and get your fix virtually. Also, all clinics 48 to 72 hours after completion will be posted on the USA Baseball YouTube channel. There's a playlist called Coaches Clinics on there. You've got 61 previous clinics to go in and just consume all you want from some of the best minds in the game. So check it out. We've got big league coaches, minor league coaches, college coaches, high school coaches, travel coaches, youth coaches, you name it. There's three clinics on there entirely in the Spanish language. There's a how to coach your players clinic in there with the players and coaches from three different levels of baseball talking together. There's a father-son clinic in there. If you're someone who coaches your son, you know, if you're a dad or a mom and you coach your son or your daughter, how to coach your own kid. There's a lot of great info on there in addition to your standard hitting, pitching, catching, and infield, outfield stuff. So a lot of great info at usabdevelops.com and on our YouTube channel. And with that, I think I'm almost done. I got to pay the bills. Special shout out to our community clinic sponsor, including the virtual clinics, Game Changer, your all-in-one scorekeeping video at scorekeeping and video app. We appreciate Game Changer's continued sponsorship and support of this program. Bills are paid. Info is out. You guys are sick of hearing me talk already. So I'm going to kick it over to Adam Rosales, hitting coach with the Oakland Athletics. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me.
All right. The floor is yours, my friend. Share your screen. Do what you got to do, and let's break it down.
Okay, cool. Let me get this up. So go to share my screen. I forgot go. All right, you guys see that?
Andrew, you're good.
All right. So I was fortunate enough to have Andrew. He asked me to talk about the offensive approach or hitting. And so I'm just going to run through really quick. Got a question to ask you guys right off the bat. As you can see, what does an efficient and a consistent offensive approach create? That's all I want you guys to think about as I'm introducing myself, as I'm giving a little background on myself. So a little background, let's see if this comes up. I've played for 6 different Major League Baseball teams, played for the Reds, the Oakland A's, Texas Rangers, Padres, the Diamondbacks, and the Indians. And got drafted in the 12th round in 2005 out of Western Michigan University. And the thing I always tell young players is that you don't have to go to ASU or LSU or any of these big time baseball schools to succeed and to meet your goals. You can go to school in a cold weather like Western Michigan and still succeed. Just taking those steps forward is the most important thing. But I was fortunate enough to take this road and to learn so much from a lot of great professional coaches and a lot of great teammates along the way. So I'm excited to share this with you tonight. And as Andrew said, I am actually the manager for the Oakland A's rookie ball team in Mesa, Arizona. So I'm loving doing that. It was my first year last year. Learned a ton. And it was an eye-opening experience because being a player and being a coach is completely different. So it was definitely eye-opening. And I'm looking forward to getting started here in a couple of weeks down in Mesa, Arizona. Let me back up a little bit. So the rundown, what we're gonna discuss tonight. I kind of like making it interactive, but obviously it doesn't seem like I can see anybody. But just want to let you guys know what we're gonna talk about. So the rundown, we're gonna define approach, talk a little bit about the mental game. I give you some counts and situations. Talk about the hitting essentials, and then maybe a couple drills at the end. And I'll try, and I know it's a lot of high school coaches on here, maybe some little league coaches. So it's a little bit more advanced, but I know you can apply this to your players. There's no question. So when I was a player, I always wanted to know what the coach was talking about. I wanted to know the same terminology and understand that we were on the same page. So a lot of coaches told me, hey, have a good plan at the plate or have a good approach at the plate. And I was like, which one is it? And what does that mean? So I'm going to break it down for you guys, what a plan is and what an approach is. So I like this analogy of an airline pilot, right? When they're actually getting ready to take off or getting ready to land, they have a plan, right? And in baseball, our plan could be to study the game, right? I always encourage young players. Doesn't matter if you're 8 years old or 28 years old. Study the game by trying to mimic your favorite ball player. Try to emulate what they do, how they move, how they run, how they slide, how they catch a ground ball. Everything, study the game, watch Major League Baseball games. If you can, go to the games so you can actually see the game work in itself. Where to throw the ball to, if it's hit to the outfield, what base to throw the ball to. Think about how fast the runners are. So this is all the plan. And with the plan, you have to go to your checklist. And we'll talk about a mental checklist, but there's so many different checklists you can have for your plan and your routine. And then finally, the third one is you got to anticipate the situation in your plan. These airline pilots, they're always anticipating what could happen, what could possibly go wrong so they can make in-flight adjustments, right? So now let's shift over. Let's talk about approach. What is approach? Number one, you have to know the situation. You can't just anticipate the situation anymore. You have to know what the situation is. And number two is my favorite. For approach, what it comes down to, approach is one pitch in one spot. So an example of that could be a fastball middle away. And that is all you need to be thinking about at the plate.
No mechanics, not worrying about what your parents are saying in the stands, what pitch is coming, or guessing what pitch. If he's got a good slider, you stick to your one pitch and your one spot. And I always like to say, trust your stuff. You have to have courage to trust your stuff. So that is approach, the difference between plan and approach. So moving on, let me ask you this question again. What does an efficient and consistent offensive approach create? A lot of players say confidence or success, and what's great, but to get to the core of it, what does a great offensive approach create? Time and space. The more time and space you can create between the baseball and your body, or the baseball and your bat head, the better off you're going to be. And if you don't have that solid approach, that space is going to be really small, and it's going to be really tough to be consistent. And when you're not consistent, it's tough to build that confidence, right? So for approach, and I know I go pretty fast, so hopefully you're following along. And I would highly recommend taking notes while you do this. I always love taking notes. I'm actually here in Chicago as well, and I'm going to the Illinois High School Baseball Convention Friday, Saturday, and I'm planning on bringing a notebook and taking notes to learn more. But guys, three in-flight adjustments for your approach. What can always be changing? Number one, the count changes from pitch to pitch. The situation can change. If there's a guy in second base, more at the high school level, right? You're trying to drive the runner over. But what happens if there's a pass ball? Now the guy's on third base and your job has changed. You're no longer trying to drive him over. You're trying to drive him in. So there's always an in-flight adjustment that you need to make to your approach. And then pitching changes can happen all the time. So you need to be ready for that and have the know-how to go back to the bench and ask your coach or your teammate, hey, have we seen this guy before? What does this guy have? Not just stand there and watch the pitcher. Go back and talk to somebody. And that helps you with your approach. For me, there's three absolutes to an approach. You know, we talked about the in-flight adjustments, but in order to have the best approach, you have to put the team before yourself. You have to have the we before me mentality, because that lets you play to win. And when you play to win, baseball's fun. You know, winning is not everything, but the will to win is my philosophy, because that lets you embrace the present moment and you enjoy the game a lot more. And I'm not going to talk too much about visualization, but you see this image up on the screen right now, a whole team celebrating. This is what I would envision starting in college, probably. I would start envisioning my teammates and me celebrating a win every day. And that helped me to be selfless and not selfish with my approach. So moving on. This is so important. A lot of players focus on results. I focused on results, I'm not going to lie. But you have to put the process in front of the results. And we're doing this study right now for this program that we have called Mindful Player. And we actually we did a survey for about 120 high school baseball players, two high school teams in Utah, two high school teams in Chicago, and one in Pennsylvania. And we asked them, what were your 2021 accomplishments? What did you value? And then we asked them, what are your 2022 goals? And it was remarkable, alarming to me that they valued their results 84% of the time when talking about their accomplishments. Oh, my batting average went up. I struck out less. These are results. I want my power numbers to go up. And only 11% said I had quality at bats. I was more consistent. That has to shift. This 84% needs to shift down and the process needs to go up. These responses should be more focused on quality at bats. And same thing with their goals. Their goals were more like 70%. They focused on the result. It's got to be focused on the process. And again, Even in the major leagues, I was focusing on results. I admit it. My goal was to get 3 hits out of 10. But I had process goals that were my priorities before my result-oriented goals. My process goal was to hit the ball hard 5 out of 10 times or swing at my strike in my strike zone at least 70% of the time. I valued those a lot more than getting 3 hits out of 10 at bats. So process over results, even at a young level, even at a young age, as parents for little leaguers, talk about the process and how great they looked in executing the little fundamentals. Batting average, not a big deal. That's just going to cause stress and anxiety for these young players. So with the mindful player, we have this routine that we follow. All these 120 high school players that are doing it right now. And I believe that your routine is everything. You have 12 seconds in between each pitch, about on average, to reset, whether that's fixing your batting glove, knocking the dirt off your cleats, or looking at the foul pole. You got to reset. You have to breathe. You need a focus cue. And a focus cue is something that you guys can see up there on the screen. See the ball. That's all you repeat to yourself. Just see the ball. Once you start thinking about the pitcher or what pitch he's throwing or something a parent says in the stands, you lose your focus cue and you can't do that. But you got to focus on a simple phrase or a word. And you have to have the courage to stick to that. And that's the mindful courage, right? And this all helps with your offensive approach. And this can start at such an early age to repeat something positive in your mind. And you keep on getting better with it. As you grow and as you mature, you only get better with this. And it's such a simple concept, but it works. So guys, one of my favorite cues was one I developed when I was in AAA in 2008, and I was so close to making it to the big leagues. And I started this focus cue called the Ring of Fire, right? And this is a little bit more advanced, right? This is more maybe high school, college, you could start. But you guys could see, I'm not sure if you could see my cursor, but for my approach, my cue was Ring of Fire, and I would stay within this red line right here. And this blue line would represent ice. If it came even close to the blue line, I would let it go. And I had to trust that because at first I didn't trust it. And I would still swing at those pitches. But eventually I let the ball go. I thought the umpire was going to call it a strike, but he didn't. He called it a ball. And I started trusting this process. I started trusting this hitting approach, this focus cue. And it really benefited me a lot. So now, talk more about hitting approach. Let's talk about different counts. And I brought up the Ring of Fire because everybody watches or plays MLB The Show, right? So you're familiar with it. So I drew these little Ring of Fire in the ice to show you how central, how specific my hitting approach was. And I'm not saying you have to have this hitting approach in Little League or in high school. I'm saying this is something that you could work for, but at least be aware of it, right? Pay attention to this. So this is where mine was in hitters counts. And I put the 3-0 in green because I feel like you have to have guts 3-0, right? It's not, your mind goes different places when you get a chance to hit 3-0, when the manager puts the green light on. So these are hitters counts, and you can see how specific, how I wouldn't swing at anything outside that red circle. And that blue area is a buffer zone that if it even came close, the ball would basically just disappear. That's how good I got at this. But you can see how much I'm giving the pitcher in hitters counts. I give him all of this, especially the inside. Right? So I give that up because if I'm looking here, that means I'm not looking where. If I'm looking here on the inside or down low, where am I not looking? I'm not looking in my hot zone, that heat map. So that's everything to do with hitting approach. Now let's talk about two-strike approach. You see how it got bigger for me, right? Now I give them a little bit of the inside. I'm covering the outside, maybe a half a ball off the plate. This is how specific my hitting approach was. And we go into different situations now. Right? Where is a pitcher trying to throw the ball in this situation? The pitcher is trying to throw the ball at the bottom of the zone, especially to try to get the ground ball, especially when the infield's playing in. Right? They want you to roll over, hit a dinker to their middle infield to throw the guy out at home plate. That's why me specifically, this is my hitting approach. I had to raise the zone. I would swing at balls out of the zone on purpose to drive, not on purpose, if I had to, out of the zone, right down the middle, high, to drive the guy in from third base. So I would eliminate this down pitch. But you think a guy like Mike Trout, do you think he has the same hitting approach? Absolutely not. I would say Mike Trout is more down here in this quadrant down here because he's a low inside hitter. So his one pitch, one spot might be low and inside, right? So know your one pitch, one spot. And I kind of got this ring of fire. My dad and I, we used to hit when I was really young. And I remember my dad would always kind of give me the vision of hitting through a window. He would stand out in front of home plate. And he said, here's a window. Make sure the ball goes through the window. And I always liked that. But as I grew older, came up with the ring of fire. It's got to go through your window in order to blast it. If it's not through your window, let it go. So that's with runners on third. What about getting the runner over? We used to say get the runner over. But that causes a lot of problems for me. Getting a run over means you're hesitant. A lot of times, I even see in professional balls with the guys that I manage with the Oakland A's, they flare the ball. They hit foul balls. We say, get the run over, they hit foul balls. But in this hitting approach, I like saying drive the runner over. So you see the center fielder out there? That's where you should be driving the ball. You will execute for the team if you have that mentality, that approach to drive the runner over. Again, it's a little bit more advanced. You can still use the cue, the coaching cue, drive the ball. I think that helps a lot of young players. But obviously, this is a little bit more advanced for Little League. This could possibly be applied in high school, though. Definitely in college. So I'm going to show you my high school approach. I'm not kidding. This is my high school and probably my college approach too. You can see how big it is. I was trying to cover everything because, yes, I'm athletic. I have good hands. I got good bat speed. And I thought I had to hit everything. But if I would have focused a little bit better, I probably could have driven the ball a lot better and maybe not have had as much strikeouts. And not the results. I'm not saying results are everything. But it would have definitely eliminated that. I would have had a better approach at the plate. I would have had a better process. But where else would I find myself in this approach? What do you think? Where else would I find myself in this approach? In the major leagues. I've had this approach in the major leagues. I think I'm sure a couple of you have already guessed. A hit and run would be a good one. You have to cover everything on a hit and run. But I'll tell you, when I'm in a slump, this is what my approach looks like. I don't have that tunnel vision. I'm playing the pitcher's game, and the game speeds up. That time and space that we're talking about, what a good approach creates, that time and space shrinks really quick if you try to hit everything. So you got to find a way to slow the game down and have a good, solid approach. So we'll move on. I'm not sure if I'm on time here. I'll try to make sure I'm on. Got about 5 more minutes or so. But so I have 4 core values when I hit. And I talk about these. There's more mechanical, but they help you with your approach. They help you create time and space. These are my 4 core values: rhythm and timing, weight transfer, connection, and finish. But for approach, there's 4 hitting essentials. And I'll explain why they matter for offensive approach. So the four are, you have to be on time. The most important part of hitting is seeing the baseball, but being on time is essential for your approach. Separation, being short and direct to the baseball, and having balance. These four are essential. These are great coaching cues to use for your players. And I'm going to explain each one. And you can see how they line up with my four core values: rhythm and timing, be on time, weight transfer, separation, connection is a short, direct swing, and finishes. You have a nice balance all the way through your swing. Be on time. When do you think your players should start their rhythm and timing? A lot of players say they start with their leg lift, with the pitcher's leg lift, or when they're at the release point. But I teach, and I firmly believe, it's when the hands break, because for the pitcher, that's the point of no return. Right? You think of Johnny Cueto. If you try to start when the guy lifts his leg, the guy can still do a lot of different stuff before he comes to home plate. You got to make sure the hands break. If it's a harder thrower, maybe start a little bit slightly before the hands break. Maybe when the elbows come up, something like that, around that time, so you can be on time, create that time and space. And then another thing, you got to make sure you see the release point, but never get stuck on the release point. I'm going to say that again. See the release point. Don't get stuck on the release point. You got to keep tracking it. For me, I tracked it all the way through my ring of fire. Right? Track it all the way to contact point. Getting stuck on release point is doomsday. Let's move on. Separation. Who is, you guys know this guy? Sure you do. It's Pete Alonso, right? He generates some of the best torque, and you can call that separation. It's when your lower half goes and your upper body stays there, right? And the reason why I bring that up for approach is because that prevents the leaking and drifting into a pitch, right? And if you leak or drift into a pitch, what happens? You lose that space and time. And once you lose that space and time, your approach is out the window. But another thing, Pete Alonso is the best at stopping his swing. We talk all the time about swinging, but we never talk about stopping your swing. And he has the best breaking system. You can make a lot better decisions when you have good separation. And I know I'm cruising through this. There's so much depth to all of these components, but I'm going to keep on moving. Have a short, direct swing, right? It's another way to create time and space. Does Rendon swing up on this baseball right here? Is his swing plane up? Yes, it is. But what happens first? Look how short and direct. Boom. And now he's on plane. He gets to the slot, then he's on plane. First things first, you have to be short and direct to the baseball. If you see a lot of kids lifting, I know launch angle and all that, hit fly balls is preached all the time. But you have to get to the baseball first. All right, balance. JD Martinez, one of the best. And the reason why balance is so key is that it prevents your head movement. If your head moves at all, that time and space is so short, you have to maintain your balance. And a way to maintain your balance, which is advanced, you have to use the ground. I see a lot of young players swinging and not holding their swing during practice. They're not holding their finish during practice. They should hit and hold their finish for at least 1 or 2 seconds. And that tells me that they're using the ground, which is their best friend, to stay balanced, which keeps your bat on plane and prevents that head movement. But ultimately, as coaches, it comes back to the mental game. We got to get these players to trust themselves so they can be consistent, right? So the question to you guys, how do we build confidence? How do we help them embrace that moment and embrace competition? It starts with preparation. I was talking to Peloton High School today, and the way I prepare, I don't prepare for spring training. I prepare for August and September, the dog days. So make sure, but that takes a lot of challenging myself in the off season. I got to make it fun. I got to make sure I'm including real game situations in practice so that they're enjoying it and so they can implement it into the game. But that is what I got on hitting approach. If anybody is interested, you guys can follow us. We have a great team of Mindful Player, but you can email me directly. I always love getting emails from you guys. So thank you so much.
What a great info there, Adam. Thanks so much for sharing with us. If you didn't have any questions for the Q&A, you need to really take a look in the mirror right now and ask if you were paying attention or not. Maybe it took you a few minutes. You know, I'm talking to you attendees. Maybe it took you a few minutes to digest everything, but hopefully you have by now. Man, I'm a visual learner. I'm not as much of a auditory learner like some people are. You know, there's different learning styles, and you had some really easy to follow along with graphics there, man. I really like the Ring of Fire. It makes a lot of sense. And it doesn't matter what age player you're talking to. You talk to a 7-year-old, a 10-year-old, a 22-year-old. I've done it all. Hey, what are you looking for right there? I don't know. Something I can hit. Right. And you know, you see the swings when, you know, you're throwing BP and, you know, it's middle. Hey, let's work away. It's away. Then you miss one and it runs in and they have no chance because all they're doing is hanging out and trying to react to what you're doing. They don't really have in their mind, like what that zone is in front of them, what that visual is. I was always a big believer in broad focus to narrow focus, you know, with that pitcher. It's broad, and then you're tightening up, and you're going from the whole thing to the shoulder, to the upper body, to the head, then to the window. Just like you said, you can't just keep your eyes on the same point for multiple seconds at a time. So a lot of really good stuff. All right, we got a couple things in the Q&A here from Tim J. Adam, any tips on building confidence in youth hitters?
Youth hitters?
We get this a lot when it comes to the youth players.
So, I mean,
the kids.
Yeah, I mean, that's everything. Confidence is everything at the youth level. I mean, I have a 5-year-old son right now. And to build his confidence, I start super small. I do side. First, we start off a tee, simple tee little work and simple stuff. But I flip to him really close. So there's like not really too much moving. We use wiffle balls. But the thing I like to do is have him hit close to a fence. Like whether it's like outside of our front yard or at a park, I move him really close to a fence and I let him hit it over the fence. So it really builds his self-esteem and his confidence. It's fun to see the ball disappear, right? Like, look what I did. So, I mean, that's one way to help is really allowing them to succeed in a really easy environment, I think. I mean, there's a lot of different ways to build confidence, but obviously the way you talk to them too is essential.
Yeah, I can see that in terms of maybe a kid struggled in a game. So when you come back, you're not just going to beat them down and challenge like crazy the next day of practice, right? You need to put them back in that. They need to learn some things. You need to teach them, but you need to allow them to experience some success because baseball is a game of failure. And kids with very short attention spans right now, coaches with short attention spans right now, right? It's like it's on to the next thing all the time. So let them experience some success and get them back. You can control that environment of practice. You can't control the environment in the game. So good point. All right, from Rich, what are your thoughts on a no-stride stance for youth with mechanical issues? If they lunge at the ball, do you just go no-stride and simplify things, eliminate the lower half, or is there something else that you would work with them?
I would make sure that if you do a no stride, you're not eliminating teaching them to load and to gather and create that rhythm and timing. I think because that's one thing. I mean, it depends how old they are. I mean, if they're 6 and 7 years old, I would say it's fine. Just any way to put the bat on the ball. But a little bit older, you know, 9, 10, 11, I would make sure that no stride's fine, but make sure they're loading and gathering at the right time. You know, we talked about the hand separation. I think that's essential. If you're not working on rhythm and timing, the ball is going to beat them, even if they're leaking into the pitch without a stride, you know?
Yeah, yeah. The younger kids, it's almost like they want to start their swing once the pitcher starts what they're doing, right? They're not ready to hit really until the pitcher's in motion. So
right, exactly. I think a good drill for that too, I mean, you could do it would be the step back drill for that rhythm and timing, because a lot of issues with their leaking, why they leak forward is because they sway back. Mm-hmm. But their first initial move is back, so they have to come forward, and it looks like a big leak. But if they could, you look at Albert Pujols and his knee drive before the pitch is even thrown, it's almost like to the ground, you know. So that's what I would say. I mean, hope that makes sense.
Yeah, it definitely does. Definitely does. All right, let's talk. You know, let's get back to the mindfulness here for a second. We talk mechanics, journaling.
Mm.
Okay. So at what age do you think it's good to break the journal out? It doesn't have to be, you know, it doesn't have to be like a purchased, you know, expensive baseball centric thing, but at what age do you think it's, I mean, I guess it's okay for any age, but what age does it encourage, you know, to journal?
I wouldn't know what age to start. I mean, I would start as soon as they could start writing, or even, you know, right. not even writing. If they can't write, or they don't want to look back, to draw something, you know, like draw like what it looked like to play that day. I don't know. At a really early age, you know, I'm talking like T-ball, maybe draw something if they don't want to write words, but something to remember the day. But I mean, I got serious with baseball when I was 12 years old, and I wish I started journaling back then. I really do. I didn't start journaling probably until I went to Western Michigan, but I really started being consistent with it that year in 2008 when I was hitting a buck 80 in June and they're about to send me down to double A and I was so close to the big leagues. That's when I started journaling, and it's amazing. Now that I look back on it, it's amazing how focused, how it helps you vent. It helps you get this cloud. Like you talk about creating time and space.
Mm-hmm.
That's one way to create that space. You know, I do a meditation app called Headspace, and that's one way to do it, is to just get it all out, whether it's venting or gratitude journal, something to get out. And it's so beneficial. I would start that at 12 years old if you coaches can have that part of your teams. But
nice. Very nice. Oh man, I appreciate it. Adam Rosales, Oakland. Sorry to get you the right intro, man. I went hitting coach. Man, you're a big time manager now.
No,
that's awesome. Thank you for jumping on and sharing tonight. We appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate being on. Thanks so much. You guys take care, right?
All right, thank you, sir. All right, let's go to my favorite topic that we have. We've got catching. We've got Andrew DeVino from Lakeland High School down in Lakeland, Florida. Also has an Instagram account with a ton of great info on there. Coach, thanks for coming on tonight.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Let's jump right in. Let's talk backstops.
Yes, sir. So I'm a Lakeland coach here in Florida. I had the privilege of being around some great catchers we have in the organization. We have one that could possibly get drafted this year. So I take very pride in catching, and I started catching about 9 years ago. I mean, started doing catching and being more consistent with it about 9 years ago. So I love doing that every day. So I'm going to share my screen with you. Are we good? Okay, so I'm going to start off talking to you guys about what I do here at Lakeland and how we run practice and what is our daily routine each and every day. So,
hey, Coach, can you go? Can you go slideshow for me, please, like from the beginning?
Yes, sir.
Full screen it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome. Perfect.
So every season we start off with a meeting. We go over what is our plan for the season, what our goals are, and what our schedule is. And right now we have four catchers, and mostly them, all of them, on varsity right now, and we're still developing some JV catchers. So. Well, we talk about what does it take to be an elite catcher. Okay, so we want to be a leader on the field. We don't have to be vocal, as in getting aggressive on players or yelling at players, but we want to lead them by example. Okay, so talk to your players, show by example your work ethic, your catching, that you're confident in your ability to play the game and to catch. So that's what we talk about first. we got to be communicators. Okay. So we're leaders on the field and we're like the quarterback of the field. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that the players know what's going on, is we need to be more knowledgeable. Okay. So when we're more knowledgeable, we could be able to lead our players and be more confident on the field and be great communicators. So that's what we talked about. We need to adapt to tough conditions. Okay. So if we're last year, we had a rough season. So we have to be able to adapt to those conditions, because our team is believing in us and they're putting all their trust in us. So we need to make sure that we could adapt with those. We could be confident. We could be positive and be there for our team. We talk about ability to be another coach on the field. Okay, so us coaches can go out there only a certain amount of time. So if we understand our pitching staff and we understand our players as catchers, we could be that second coach on the field. We always talk about Yadier Molina, how he's another coach on the field. He knows what's going on. He knows how to call the game. He knows how to deal with his pitchers. He knows when he needs to go out there and slow them down or go out there and make sure that the pitcher feels comfortable, okay? Knows that his catcher has his back. So we have to be good coaches on the field. We talk about outwork our competition. Here in Polk County, we have a lot of great catchers. So our goal each and every day is how we can outwork our competition, how we outwork each player, each catcher that we're going to play against each and every day throughout the season, because we believe that we have one of the best districts in the country and we have a lot of great players within our district. So we want to make sure that we're doing what we need to do each and every day to be a better catcher and be better than our competition. We like to compete in practice and games. So within practice, we need to compete against each other. Competition is good. We preach that a lot, that when we're competing against each other, yeah, we have four catchers. Yeah, we're all competing for playing time, but it's good because that competition is making our catchers a lot better and it's going to relate to the games. So I'm going to keep going here. Being prepared every day, every game, before game, our job is to be prepared for that game. Know who's pitching, know what pitches are going to be thrown by that pitcher. Know our opponent, know their weaknesses, their strengths. We play teams over and over again in our district. So we need to go over our scouting report and know what we're doing before we get into that game. What we preach to our catchers is being able to adapt to different stances, because in catching, we could be knee down, we could be in the stance, we could be in the hybrid stance, we could be in the secondary. We have to be able to know what stances that we could be in for certain pitches and how that will work for us and will it be the most efficient for us. So we have to be adaptable to that. We talk about good relationship with pitching staff. Like I said before, we need to make sure that our pitchers know that they can trust us, that we have their back, and just throw the ball and we're going to catch it. And we're going to make sure that we fight hard for you to win those strike balls and get those pitches called strikes. As catchers, we want to work well with umpires, okay? So what we preach to our catchers is go out there, introduce yourself, introduce you to the umpire, know his name, have a good relationship, don't get him mad because we want those calls. And when we talk to the umpire, we always talk with our mask on. We look forward, so we never show him up or disrespect him. We're a facilitator on the field. We have to make sure that we're having our players in the right positions because we're seeing the field out in front of us. So we need to make sure that our players are in the right positions. So we're communicating to put them in those right positions. So we need to make sure that we facilitate all our players on the field. I'm very big on paying attention to detail, okay? Because when we practice, sometimes we could just catch the ball, throw it back, or even bullpen, catch the ball, throw in the back. I want to pay attention to detail. I want to pay attention to every single rep that I have. We're working on that detail, working on getting better. Flexibility, mobility, nowadays we need to be very flexible. We need to be able to to be mobile. If we need to sway, we need to move quick, and we need to be athletic. That's one of the most important things that we preach to our catchers here at Lakeland is we need to be flexible, meaning stretching every day. We got to be mobile and athletic. So the good thing about four catchers that we have is that they all play different positions. Some plays infield, some plays outfield, and that makes them more athletic. And the more athletic you could be, the better you could be behind the plate. So we like to preach that a lot. We go into order of priority. Here, I'm very big on receiving. I'm going to spend more time on receiving than anything else. I feel that if we get those strike balls, call for strike, we fight hard on those corner pitches, that low in the zone pitches, and we get strikes, we can leave runners off the bases. So we're very, I take serious receiving. We have to be able to receive the ball. We have to be able to catch the ball. That's the most important thing before you can do anything else is receive. So we work a lot on receiving. Blocking and throwing come after. This past two seasons, we had 20 stolen base attempts. Nobody was really running too much on us because we had two catchers that could really throw the ball to second base. So we work on throwing to second, and we work on those transfers and forward, but we're going to do that a little bit at a time. We're going to receive, and we're going to block more, okay? Because I feel like that's the two most important things before throwing. Nowadays, not too many people steal, or if you have a good catcher back there that could catch the ball, keep the ball in front of him blocking, maybe they might not run as much. So we did a statistic the last 2 years, and we're receiving and blocking more than throwing. So that's what we're going to work on more. So our stances, there's many stances. There's traditional two-point stance. There's right knee down, left knee down, right knee down, and a kickstand position, a left knee down, kickstand. Then you got your secondary, your hybrid, and then your traditional stance that mid-pitch you might drop down to one knee to catch that breaking ball that's down or that fastball that's down that you want to beat it to the spot and make sure that it's called a strike. Move it back into the strike zone. Make sure it's called a strike. If we let it travel too deep, now the allusion to the umpire that is too low, he's not going to see it too well, and maybe we don't get that pitch. So with my catchers, I leave it to them. I give them the flexibility to try every stance, see what works for them and what positions, what pitches are being thrown, and how they could be the most effective, direct to the ball and being able to receive the ball into the strike zone. So I leave it up to them. There is times that I tell them that, okay, when there's two outs or there's a man on base, two strikes, or if there's a man on base, we're not going to go down, okay, because we don't have big league pitchers or college pitchers that we know that the ball is going to be where we call it. So we're not going to go down. We're going to prevent that. We're going to be able to block better. If there's a man on third, we're definitely not going to go down to one knee. So we're going to stay in a traditional stance. So we got to be able to catch in our traditional stance and be able to catch on one knee. So that's what we work on here. As you see right here, I have one of our catchers in different stances. So every year we try out our different stances, see what works and what pitches are thrown. And if it's on the corner of the plate, or if we're asking for the pitch high, we're going to stay up high a little higher. Or if we're asking for that pitch down, maybe we'll go one knee. So we want them to work on every single stance to make sure that they're comfortable in that stance. Now, each stance varies for different players. If I got a player that's tight, that it's hard to stay in a two-point stance, maybe we go to one knee. Or if a player's tall, maybe we go to one knee. If I got a player that's more mobile, we could get into different stances, and that's why we got to see what works for that player. So though, when we talk about our stances, we also talk about angling on pitches. I think a lot of the times that this is not talked about as much. We talk about it a lot, and we found that it's effective for us. It works for us. The umpires like it in our games, and we're getting pitches called strikes. So we're going to angle on the corners. So we angle setups are used for pitches that are on the corners. When a catcher angles to the plate, it allows the umpire to get a better view. Okay, he's sitting in the slot. He has a better view I mean, if umpire is uncomfortable with you angling, he's going to let you know. But for the most time, we're going to angle. We're going to get those corner pitches because we want that ball going straight to our chest. We don't want to have to reach extension side or reach out for that ball. So if we're staying straight up to the pitcher, now that fastball that's cutting across, that slider's cutting across, now we're reaching, and now it looks like a ball to the umpire and to everybody else on the field. If I angle, now that ball's coming straight to my chest, and I have minimal movement back into the strike zone to present that pitch to the umpire. So we work on this a lot. We're not going to do it with runners on base because we're angling outside. We want to be in a good secondary position. So that's why we don't do that with runners on base. So I'm going to go into receiving. There's a big debate everywhere you go to every convention with the new school, old school, how you catch, how the glove is presented. For me, we have a few catchers and one of our catchers like to catch it with his glove like this. He's able to stay under the ball. He's able to get that, work that pitch back into the strike zone. And that helps him. I have other catchers. We catch with our elbow up a little bit. With our pocket wide is down, I feel that's a little bit better because now that slider that's coming down, that fastball that's cutting across, if we're here, most of the time, if we don't get under it or we don't get to the ball quick enough, our thumb is in the way. So I'd rather be here so I have a bigger pocket and a bigger position for the ball to get in, and now I move it back up into the strike zone. So we teach thumb down to thumb up. And when you present it to the umpire, it's a flat glove with the sign of the glove facing up. So I feel that that has worked for us. And our catchers, the catchers that I changed to do that style of catching, they've been successful the last few years. So that's what we work on. We talk about pre-pitch glove movement, which I'll show in the next slide. It's about rhythm and timing. We got to make sure that our pre-pitch is working and our glove is working through the ball into the strike zone. If it's high, if it's a strike, we're going to hold it and make sure that it's a strike. But if it's a strike ball, it's a low percentage pitch, I want to make sure that I fight hard to get to that pitch and make it a strike. Our pocket awareness, what I just talked about, wide glove, we're here, making sure that our pocket is to the ball and that we're target spot is right inside here. Okay, we don't want it here. We don't want it off the thumb and possibly break our thumb. And so we want to be elbow slightly high, glove going downwards, and then we work up. Control the pitch. That's most important for us is control the pitch and make sure that a strike is a strike. We're not trying to make a strike more than a strike. We're not trying to fool the umpire. We want to make sure we control that pitch. After that pitch is in that ball's in our glove, we don't want any more movement after that. So that's why we try to move before we catch the ball, working the ball back into the strike zone if it's out of the strike zone. But when it's in the strike zone, we want to stick it, hold it there, give good presentation to the umpire. Quiet head. We want to make sure that our head is quiet. The more movement in our head, the more that the umpire is moving, our body's going to end up moving. We're not going to have good path to the ball, and maybe we're not going to have a clean catch. Okay, so we want to make sure that we're quiet with our head, so we're keep our eyes on the ball. So talking about pre-pitch, we want a loud target, okay? We want to hold that target up as long as we can here so the pitcher has a target to throw to and he's got his eyes on the target. Once that pitcher breaks his hands, that's when we're starting to relax our wrist. We're dropping our wrist. We're working on our rhythm and timing and staying under the ball, okay? So we want to stay there as long as we can until he breaks his hands because we don't want to move our glove too much because then it messes with the eyes of the pitcher and we don't want to ruin his focus. So like I said before, wide pocket allows the ball to have a bigger spot to get into your glove. And we don't want to move the glove as much. We want to be on time to the pitch. If we're late, we're going to miss the ball or the ball is going to be rattling and we're not going to be able to get a clean catch. And our setup, we want to make sure that we're setting up right on time. You don't want to set it up too early. You don't want to set it up too late. You set it up too late, now you're messing with the vision of the pitcher. You set up too early, now you're giving the pitches away because the batter could look back and now he sees what location that you're going. So here we have one of our pitchers at Lakeland, loud target, relaxes the wrist, stays underneath, elbow stays slightly above the glove. Now he's going to do that in a two-point stance, and then he's going to go down to one knee and work the same way. Going to get through this a little bit quicker here. Receiving, these are some drills that we do here at Lakeland. The first one, we got a wiffle ball machine. It's the personal pitching machine. So we're going to work on receiving here with our mini blue glove and working on pocket awareness. Our second drill, I'm up high, and we're going to work on elevated throws, working on that negative angle going downwards from the pitcher. Then we're going to go into our rolling ball receiving drill, staying under it, thumb down, working the ball into the zone, and then a pick ball. Now, this is our catcher on the right, very good catcher, Houston commit. He's more of a traditional, keeps his glove here, but he stays under the ball majority of the time. Then we got our rapid fire drill, our receiving, and then our roving glove, working on different paths to the ball early, making sure our pocket is to the ball, working upwards. Then we got, like I said, I'm big on receiving, so we do a lot more receiving drills than any other drills. So we got our frisbee drill right here, working on our thumb down and working through the frisbee. On the right, we got our clean fuego receiving drill. I think it's really good. I throw the clean fuego a certain way. The catcher has to match the plane of the fuego, make sure when he catches it, that clean fuego is flat in the glove. And he's going to tell me every time whether it is or not. We got our keyhole drill, keyhole receiving drill. All-Star hasn't made this yet, but they're going to be making it out within a year. So what we do here, I made it. I took an All-Star glove. I ripped it out and put a lacrosse netting on it. So we work on that with our receiving. Then we got our J-band, trying to control the pitch, making sure once we catch it, we have little, as less movement as possible. Then our glove on our head drill, we do this to minimize head movement. So making sure that our head's staying still. If we're moving too much, our head, the glove is going to fall off. So that's instant feedback for the player. And then our inside drill, pitch inside, going the glove side, making sure we're staying outside the ball, working it back in. So now we're going to go into blocking. We preach a lot here that glove leads the way of the body. Okay, the body will follow. The glove needs to lead the way. Whichever direction the glove is going, the body will follow that direction. But if we lead with the glove early, we can make sure that if we miss the pitch or we're late to the ball, at least our glove is going to stop it. When blocking, we want to make sure that we're on time to the ball. If we're not on time to the ball, our posture is going to be bad and we're not going to be able to block as well. We want to make sure that our body is in control. Be in control of your body. Making sure when we go down that we're not turning sideways, we're square to the ball unless we're going to round the ball on the pitches that go outside. Drive the glove straight into the ground. Stay above the ball. Keep our eyes on the ball. Our most important thing is absorb the ball. Do not push the ball, absorb the ball. When we go down to block, we want to block with our knees in a little bit. We're going to drop to the inside part of our knees to make sure that we have control of our body and we absorb the ball. We want passive movements rather than aggressive. We don't want to be aggressive blocking and push the ball away. We want to make sure that we absorb it. What I teach here is inhale before the pitch is thrown. And if you need to block, exhale. By exhaling, you're softening your body, okay? You don't want your body to be too hard. You want to be soft. And then when we go down, we want to round our shoulders. Round our shoulders, be a bigger target, okay? The narrower we are, the more the ball can bounce off us or get past us. So we want to round our shoulders, be a bigger target. So here's some drills that we do to work on that. Put a bat behind, make sure that we're blocking to the lower part of our midsection. Then here is a drill that I got from Yadi Molina, using the Valley training glove. When we block, making sure we see it, we're stopping it with our head to make sure that it stays in front of us. Then we got our one knee kickstand that we work on, making sure that we're able to block in different stances. So maybe we might not use this in the game as much, but we have in our back pocket if that situation occurs. We do some lateral blocking from side to side, always trying to get around the ball, keeping the ball in front of us, work it back to the middle of the plate. Then we have our walk-up drill that we do and our timing blocking drill. Standing up, hands up, make sure we drive that glove into the ground, keep it on the floor, and be on time for the block. Then we like to be athletic and make sure that we're quick side to side. So we have a circle drill that we do. Lead with the glove, get around the ball. Then I have a resistance band. I'm pulling the catcher here, pulling them back. He's going to push off with that right foot and making sure that he leads with the glove and keeping the glove low. So with our transfer, I just got ahead there for a second. Am I good on time, coach?
Yes, sir, about 3 more minutes.
Okay, so run through this. We're talking transfers and our footwork and throw. We want to be aggressive. We teach be aggressive on the field, okay? We don't want to be scared that we're going to make a mistake throwing. So we teach our catchers, be aggressive. We are hunting the runners, okay? If we need to back pick, we need to throw somebody out. We want to be aggressive, and we want to be fearless on throwing people out. Our setup, we're in traditional secondary, either a hybrid secondary and a one knee down. Most of the time that we're in our traditional secondary when there's a man on base. When throwing to the bases, we want to create momentum. We don't want to step back. We want to step slightly forward, create the momentum going forward. The more we step back, now we're just throwing all arms and upper body, and we're making the distance to second base longer. We want to make sure that our transfer is fast. So here we teach, catch the ball here and three-quarter turn into our hand. We want to feed our hand. So we try to work on that a lot. I'm going to skip ahead a little bit. These are some of the drills that we do here at Lakeland. Isolating the hands, let the ball travel, work through the transfer. We do a standing up as well. And then we work on our forward. We work on our footwork here, making sure that we're athletic, we're fast, and we're moving to the second base. Then I have a resistance band. It's on his lower back hip. We're working on driving that foot forward, and we're throwing off our back leg. And then we got our pick drills, balls in the dirt. Our players like that. It's been effective, so we work on that. Then we have an alignment drill, making sure that our shoulders are lined up and that our footwork is also lined up as well. Then I go into vision training drills. I start with our noodles here, our swimming noodles. You could add noodles. I do two here. You could do four. And the catcher really needs to focus on that ball. That ball's coming out of the machine at a high velocity, and he really needs to focus on that ball. We do it with receiving and we do it with transferring. Then I also use the Victor ball. You can see here, a different light comes up each time. I tell the catcher which direction, which light is going to go in. And he has to get quick with it. His brain has to work faster. He has to react faster. So we work on that. And then we use the vision tracking discs that from slow the game down. We work on that. It's pretty hard there. It helps the eyes, and it translates into the game and works well in the game. This is a training, a schedule that I do every season. I work out each week. It's different things each week. And each week, each day has different different practice plan. We're going to work on different things each day, different drills. And like I said, priority is going to be receiving, and then we go from there. I got this from Coach Aaron at an ABCA convention, and I started doing it with one of my a few of my players. They loved it. They have different progressions, and they compete against each other. We videotape it. I put an overlay box over it, and then they watch after it and making sure that they're receiving the pitches in the strike zone. They have a lot of fun with it. At the end, you have a little prize. Then I'll do it real quick. We have our practice plans before the game and at the field when we go to the game. Before the game, we go over our game plan. We discuss other teams' rosters, what our catcher needs to know. We need to be prepared as always, so I make sure that I prepare our catchers each and every time for every game. Whether we played the team before, so I get the charts, show where they hit the ball, which player does what, and which player hits which pitch. So we go over that. We go over our starting pitching and find out who's pitching that night from our head coach, and we make sure we go over what pitches that pitcher throws so the catcher is aware of that. And then after that, we receive those pitches off the machine, and we receive velo off the machine. Then we get in our cars because our field is about 10 minutes away at Florida Southern. So when we get to the stadium, we're going to do dynamic stretch routine. We're going to work on that. We do our J-band routine. Then we get into the bullpen, and that's where we do some of our exercises. Bare hand, receiving from all setups, two knee transfers, standing forward transfers, regular forward to each base, and then our blocks and block recovery and drive blocks. After that, we review our plays, make sure that our catcher knows all our signs. We have a lot of signs, so we have a wristband as well, but we want to make sure that we go over that each and every game. After the game, we analyze the game video. We go over that game video. We look at what we did well, what we need to work on, and that's how we go on throughout the week. Also discuss things with them about the game situation and what they were thinking in those situations or what they would have done if they had the opportunity in that situation. As you can see, to the left was a chart that I started when I first started at Lakeland. Then I evolved to a better chart. I give these charts to the players each and every game, after each and every game, so they see what's going on, what they need to work on, what were their times, what pitches they really caught positive, and which pitches they maybe they could have done better on. Then after the season, we give these notes out and we go over charting all the pitches that they caught, what they need to work on in the off season, what they did very well throughout the season, what our goals are for the next season, and what will be our training plan for that off season. So we go over all that, make sure that they have all these notes and all these reports after every season. Right here is just a picture of some of the tools that I use each and every day. I go over, I use these training tools with all my catchers and even with my training catchers. These are important essentials of our daily routines. That's all I have. If you any questions or if you need to contact me, everything's there. My email, my phone number, and my social media accounts.
Excellent, man. Love the videos. Love seeing drill examples. Coach Domino, thank you. I'm a little over our time, but hey, so we got that Q&A in there. We can just tighten that up a little bit if need to. So great stuff. Let's do Q&A. Any catching questions, firemen to the Q&A button down below. If you're here for a few minutes with Coach Domino, and we've got about 6 minutes to knock that out. First one right off the get-go. Sean, hey, Sean, check mine, open New York. Great to see you on tonight. Truly appreciate the presentation. Do you mention that your catchers play other positions due to athletic ability? Have you ever converted a position player to catcher based on their tools? Or has it always been the other way around?
No, of course. If I got a player that's athletic and he has a great arm, and he could catch well, I'm going to put him back there. I got that example from when I was working with one of the coaches with the Cleveland Indians, and they drafted a player from here in Florida as a shortstop. And when they brought him to spring training, they transferred him into a catcher. And now he's one of the top catchers in their organization. So I have nothing against if a kid has the tools and he's athletic and he's mobile. Yeah, why not? Let's try him back there. Because if he has a good arm and he could throw it down there, we could teach him how to catch.
Great. Very great. So I know you have a little – your players have a little bit more freedom than other places around the country, where they get out and stretch that arm out more frequently. I mean, they can throw pretty much year round if they want to. How many, like when you're in season, right, you're gearing up to play games, how many days a week are you prioritizing throwing to bases, and what's that look like for you?
We're going to play about 2-3 times a week most of the time. So I'm looking as our schedule, we're just throwing maybe 2 times to the bases. And if 2 days a week, and if we're going to throw to the bases those times, we're going to throw very light, because I want to make sure that their arms are strong. They're not sore for our games. Like I said, we have a few catchers, so not every catcher catches every game. So they should be okay, their arm. But I don't want to wear out their arm as our season is long, 25 games plus postseason. So we try to do it about 2 times a week, and they're going to long toss the other times as well before practice or before games.
Very good. Pretty common question we get here for the catching guys from Kenny. Do you want the throwing hand behind the back, the thigh, or the heel preference, and why? The why behind it.
I keep it in the hip. I used to put it behind the glove, but I feel now you limit your range of motion when you put it behind the glove. Right. So I put it more in the hip. We protect it. You're going to get hit with a foul ball, but at least if we're there, we protect it a little more. Our chances of getting hit with a foul ball is a little less. And then it's actually, I found with our players, it's a lot easier to go from the hip to the glove when we're transferring. And they feel that it's more cleaner and quicker. Behind the back, maybe with your younger kid that maybe doesn't understand how to protect his hand, maybe lets his hand out. Yeah, put it behind the back because we don't want him to get hurt and not want to catch anymore. But as you get older, I'm a guy at the hip right there. If you feel more comfortable down by your leg, that's fine. But I teach more by the hip.
Okay, I'm with you on that, definitely. But less surface area to cover, right, than if it's back on your heel, things like that. And obviously, as they get older, they know how to get out of the way better. You know, they know how to anticipate better. So, you know, your varsity high school catchers, they know how to do that. I love seeing the spreadsheet and having a plan for your catchers. I'm still that you know, bitter guy that had to just catch bullpens over and over and over and catch bullpens. And, hey, you can get some swings if you can. Man, having a plan for your catchers like that on paper, it's got to be makes your job a lot easier. And do the catchers enjoy having that much work to do?
Yeah, I mean, each and every day they ask me for hey, what we're doing today. They want to work each and every day. Right now we're about 5 days a week. We're Monday through Saturday right now. Our preseason is about to start next week. So what we try to do is 40 minutes each day. So if I could get 40 minutes in the beginning of practice from 2:30 to maybe 3:15, and then from there, now I could get them position reps at their positions. And then after that, our coach does hitting. So they're in hitting groups, so they're getting to do every aspect of the game. So they're very pleased, and they're happy that we get to do catching each and every day and for that amount of time. So I try to take as much catching in a little bit of time and try to make sure that I get all those drills covered before we go to our positions.
That's great, man. 40 minutes a day for the catchers. It's outstanding. Good for you. Good for you doing that at the high school level. All right. That's going to wrap us up here with Andrew DeVino at Lakeland Senior High School. Got some great, great content on social media. Check out that Instagram, Twitter account. Coach DeVino, thanks for joining us tonight, man. Really appreciate it.
I greatly appreciate the opportunity. Thanks, guys.
All right. This is the one place where we prioritize the catchers and we put them in front of the pitchers. Everyone else, they bow to the pitchers, right? Understandably. So this is the one place where your host was a catcher, coached catchers, also coached pitchers, but I'm going to prioritize those backstops, man. So they go first. Now we're going to go over to the pitching side. The guys on the mound who are throwing it to the catchers, Derek Johnson, Major League pitching coach, and I believe now also pitching coordinator for the Cincinnati Reds, correct?
Yeah, director of pitching.
Director of pitching. Very good. Very good. Well, DJ, thanks for fitting us into your schedule tonight. We appreciate it. And look forward to what you've got for our attendees.
Yeah, thanks, Bart. Really appreciate being here, guys. And, you know, always happy to do some of these things. You know, the way I look at it, it's, you know, trying to serve our coaches and also serve our youth players across the country. So, you know, a really important job that you guys have, and something that, you know, certainly I want to take part in as much as I possibly can. With that being said, I really wrestled with, you know, maybe what topic to come up with. I think one of the harder things for me is, you know, to put myself in a place where, you know, where you guys are at. And I mean that from a standpoint of, I haven't coached very many 9-year-olds lately. And, you know, and so it's really just trying to figure out what might be important for you, or what things that you could use that I could offer you. And, you know, after wrestling around with it for a couple of days, I came up with, it's basically something we kind of tore out of our playbook, our minor league playbook. But it's basically how to run practices. And, you know, so the title for tonight, it's how can practices be fun, produce reaches, and transfer to the game. We have 10 of them. I'm sure there are more, and, you know, but there are 10 that we came up with. And essentially it's just a guideline for our coaches to follow, you know, to maybe look back on. We certainly don't have as much practice time as you guys, because a lot of our practice time happens before the game. So we want to be as efficient as we possibly can. And, you know, so these are sort of the important pieces that we felt like we would sort of ring out of the rest of it. So there are 10 of them. Like I said, the first one I'll start with, it's called Fill Your Cup. It's 5 to 10 minutes. I think it's really important that you connect with your players prior to engaging in you know, any sort of practice activities. So it's a little bit like a chalk talk. It could be on the field. It can be a video clip. And it can really be anything that might be important for you and your team at that point. You know, I've seen different videos of change up progressions, or listening to a big league pitcher talk about certain elements of his game. You know, every year I start out the season by bringing in a bag of jelly beans, a bag of marshmallows, and a rock with one of those long lighters that you light a fire with. And we talk about the three types of players. There's the marshmallow, the jelly bean, and the rock. And, you know, I'm talking to major league pitchers with this. So I think it can apply to you guys too. But the moral of the story is, you know, if you light fire or apply pressure to the marshmallow is kind of spongy on the outside, spongy on the inside. You light the fire to him, you put pressure on him, it doesn't take long before that marshmallow melts. Jelly bean has the hard exterior and the soft inside, and you apply heat or pressure to him, and, you know, he's going to last for a little bit, and, you know, but sooner or later, it's going to get to the middle and it's going to go soft on him right away. And then there's the rock. And that player is a guy that, you know, you apply pressure to, and it's hard on the inside, hard on the outside. And, you know, you just can't phase him. And, you know, it's just a way of kind of talking about, like, you know, what kind of player are you? We developed what we called Rock of the Week out of it, where I do give a rock to one of our pitchers per week for a good performance. That could be, you know, getting out of a jam in one of the games that we play that week. It could be for, you know, a starting performance. You know, it can really be a number of things that we would give the Rock of the Week for. But, you know, I think the bottom line is trying to fill their cup as much as they can. It can obviously be humorous, which our guys love, but just a great way to start, you know, start the practice. Number two, keep it short and concise. And this is something that we talk a lot about in spring training when we do have a little bit more practice time. I've been involved. I've been a college coach. I've been a coordinator. So I've seen a lot of different ways to practice. And, you know, one of the things that I can tell you is I've been a part of 5 hour and 6 hour practices. I've been a part of 1 hour practices. And I just tell you that I think that, most kids sort of run out of steam. They sort of lose interest. I think if we're doing it right and we're planning it out almost to the minute, we can keep guys moving. We can keep them engaged. And I think that's really important for our sport. I mean, we're losing people all the time because it's boring. And I think, you know, if we can keep it sort of action packed in the way that we practice, we become more efficient and we get out of there a little bit quicker too. The game takes a long time, but practice doesn't have to for us to be efficient and to do, you know, to do well in it. The second part of that is just being balanced. I think we're at a point where we spend a lot of time. I use the terminology skills and abilities. Abilities would be like a bigger, faster, stronger type of feel to it, training type of feel to it. Whereas the skill would be like how to pitch. And I think we're spending obviously a lot of time on the training piece of it. And there's nothing wrong with that. But I think if you look at it sort of as a timeline, I think there's a time and a place for training. And I think then there's a time and a place for building skill. And so I think looking at it from a practice standpoint, being able to balance that out, almost like keeping a checklist of, you know, here are my skills, here are my abilities. Are we evening this out during practice? And, you know, I'd say that, you know, some of you will find if you're truthful with yourself, you know, you're probably really, really heavy on one side or the other. But I think the goal is to try to find, you know, sort of that middle road. And I think you could even take something like a throwing program and look inside of it for those opportunities for ability development, you know, throwing the ball harder, and then also skill development, whether that's a pickoff move, whether that's holding runners, whether that's spinning a breaking ball, whatever that might be. But I think, you know, like kind of looking at our athletes as two parts, like we're building an engine inside of them, but we also have to build a good player. And so our practices are certainly going to reflect that. Number three, and this is probably a spring training thing because we have so many people there, but I think you can understand if you have 15 guys on your team or 15 pitchers, if you have 10, you know, obviously you have to kind of figure out what your number is, but we talk a lot about no breadlines, meaning, you know, we don't want one activity to go on. PFP is kind of famous for that, right? You know, you're covering first and you got a line of 10 guys and you're knocking a ball to the first baseman, he's catching it, you know, and your pitcher's covering. You can get so much more done. You know, it kind of goes back to that number two of keeping it short and concise. But it goes back to that of saying, like, we can get a lot more done if instead of it being one line, now we've created two or three lines and we're working on two or three things. We can get our infielders included in that. So now we've got a pick at second base, or we've got a suicide squeeze at home. We've got cover first and we've got bunts going to third. You know, and you can be pretty creative in terms of how you would go about that. But, you know, I think that's a big piece. Same thing, like you got one catcher in the bullpen, you know, instead of it being one guy going and then the next guy going, figure out a way to make it a competitive bullpen, script it out, you know, have five guys in line, they're throwing a pitch, the next guy gets up, throws his pitch, and you can play pig or horse with it, you know, something along those lines. So there are ways of making it doable with whatever it is that you have, and you can do it in a much more efficient way. Number four, and this one is really, I think, pretty important. It's developing reaches, and reaches are tasks that are meant to be kind of too hard for the level of play. But I equate it to this. It's like, you know, playing with an older brother or his group of friends is a reach. You know, like when you're the younger brother, you're reaching to try to stay at or get to the level that those guys are playing at, and you're failing a lot. These guys are beating up on you because you're the little brother. On the other side of it, like if we, you know, if everything is set to where we're succeeding, I'm afraid that we're probably playing the wrong game. I mean, we know that baseball is hard. We know that baseball is a failing game in some, you know, some circumstances, you know, so we have to develop reaches inside of our practices, and doesn't have to be all the time. You know, but I do think that there should be some setups to where, you know, we are making guys reach for that failure and sharpen the sword a little bit. One example I can give you is instead of your catcher, you know, catching all your bullpens, you know, put a nine pocket strike zone. And, you know, you can get any sort of strike zone that you want. But there's failure in that because it's a little bit tougher to hit. You know, the glove moves and the catcher can usually catch the ball. But if you're the guy throwing the baseball and it's not going to be inside of that nine pocket or in that big square, you know, it goes to the backstop. And, you know, in some ways, that's a failure. It, you know, if you've ever had a pitch back in your backyard, you know that when it goes left, right, or up or wherever, like you got to go chase the ball. So it forces you to focus on the things that you're trying to focus on. And I think you can look at a lot of different areas of the game and find reaches. You know, it's just really a matter of kind of being creative and then figuring out what it is that you think you need to reach for. Another one, and I think this is again, fairly important, but it's like allow for exploration. You know, inside of that concise, efficient practice, you know, there can be some free play involved. You're working on a changeup and during catch play, you know, some of the exploration is, you know, hey, we're going to work on a changeup. Let's see how many ways you can throw it. Give them some guidance or some guardrails as to maybe how to go about that. But then let them play with some of the differences, let them come up with some things on their own. Moving on sides of the rubber. You know, it's amazing how many times I ask guys why they're on certain sides of the rubber. And it's amazing, really, what they say. A lot of times it's like, well, it just feels comfortable. There's really no rhyme or reason for it. But what you may find on putting a guy on the other side of the rubber is, you know, the ball comes out a little bit cleaner. It looks like he's able to sort of get through the strike zone a little bit better. You know, there are certainly some ways, maybe like if you're throwing a breaking ball at this point where, you know, the shape of the breaking ball looks a little bit different in terms of being able to throw it for a strike. I think that's probably the way, you know, I can see it. Another catch play idea, leg lifts. You know, we talk about being quick to the plate all the time and we want to put a number on it. Let's say it's 1.3. Have a little bit of free play in there where you're giving the opportunity for the pitcher to experiment with different size leg lifts. You know, one may be the highest that he can get to, you know, one may be somewhere in the middle of that somewhere. And then, you know, one may be like, I'm just lifting my foot. And what you'll find is, you know, A, some of his mechanical stuff will clean up. But B, what he may find is sort of the right passageway for him, if you will, to throw the ball efficiently and sort of get what you wanted out of it, which was maybe being a little bit quicker to the plate. Number six, measure what's meaningful. You know, baseball is a game. There's a lot of statistics. There's a lot of stuff out there. I think it can be really simple. We created something and we've done this every spring training for the last 3 or 4 years. We have a championship belt and it's like the, you know, the wrestling WWE championship belts you've seen, you know, in places. And we do it off of, you know, a few different, just a few different simple stats, winning battle counts. We keep track of that all through spring training, and battle counts for us are 0-0, 1-1 and 3-2. And it's obvious, right? Like we want to win the first pitch as much as we possibly can. We want to win that 1-1 pitch as much as we possibly can. You know, and then 3-2 is sort of that payoff pitch that we need to win, you know, in order to keep the game moving. We do a thing called win the race to two strikes. How fast can you get to two strikes? You can get there in 2, 3, 4 or 5 pitches. We're going to give points or assign points based on how fast they get there. You know, we may do a scripted bullpen where we have for that particular week, you know, we want guys to try to do certain things. We'll assign points to that. And then we develop a leaderboard, which I think is a pretty cool, like, inner team competition type of thing during spring training. And we post that where everyone can see it. And you've got guys who are in the lead, and you'd be surprised like how many guys get really competitive with it and try to win that thing, you know, the championship belt. Then we have a little ceremony at the end of spring training and award the, you know, award the belt. And so it's bragging rights, you know, for our guys. And even though they're big leaguers, it's still important to them. One concept, and hopefully you guys have heard this terminology before, but it's a concept called blending. And blending essentially is taking a certain skill and sort of breaking it down. Like, you could call it a drill if you'd like, you can call it progression. You can call it really anything that you want to, but blending is sort of a way to enhance or increase the time rate that it, you know, to acquire skill. And so blending may be something like you're working on a piece of your delivery and you have a drill or two that you want to do, you know, that you think is going to help that part of the delivery. So instead of doing the drill as a standalone, you know, perhaps before he gets on the mound or he does that during catch play, you're going to blend it in with, you know, his bullpen. So he may do two or three drills off of the side of the mound, or it can be on it, you know, depending on what the drill is. And then he's going to throw two or three regular pitches. Then he's going to do the drill again, and then maybe three or four more pitches. And you can sort of script it the way that you want to based on, you know, what it means to you or what kind of skill you're trying to develop. But I found that that's probably the most powerful thing that we can do to, you know, just like enhance our return on training time, right? Like, it's being able to get there a little bit faster. And I found that that's probably one of the best things that I've done in the past or our coaches can do, you know, just in order to get these guys going a little bit quicker. Examples, and they can be really simple, and I tried to keep them simple for tonight, but like a distance pin on a changeup. So instead of it being, you know, whatever your normal footage is for your group, you know, you back up 10, 12 feet, he throws his changeup, you know, so that'd be that two or three pitches with the lengthier bullpen. Now he come back to normal distance and he's thrown his changeup. You could do the same thing on the other side, going short to long. I'm going to go short with my breaking ball, really try to get a feel for spin and how the action of the pitch is supposed to happen and the feel of it. And then I move back, you know, after that blending phase. But it's basically going back and forth in between the drill and then the activity or the bullpen itself. You know, a lot of constraints you can work with there too. You know, a changeup, I may have an open stride changeup. So I'm starting open stride and I'm trying to feel sort of that pronation and that internal rotation of my shoulder with the changeup. And then that's blended with normal pitches off the mound, trying to feel that same thing as I'm throwing the pitch. Talk about it all the time, right? Like, trying to make the bullpen as game-like as possible. It's hard to do, right? I mean, because we're not in a game and, you know, the consequences of it aren't as unforgiving maybe as sometimes the game. But just a few notes that I thought of, like, you know, making sure there's wind up and stretch involved. And I know, you know, everyone talks about that, but it's amazing. Like, I got guys that get up there all the time and are out of the wind up the entire time. And then they forget about the stretch. So just making sure that you are getting, you know, an adequate number of pitches out of the stretch. Stopwatch for time, you know, times to the plate. Ghost runners, you know, one of the things that happens when we start thinking about the running game and trying to make a pitch is simply getting our eyes back on our target when we're looking at the runner at second base, or, you know, we have our head down or something like that with the runner at first base. So, you know, getting the ghost runners and emphasizing the idea of getting our eyes back on the target, it's a small thing, but it's one of the bigger things that has to happen in order for command. So we don't want to take a chance on that if we don't have to, and we want to make sure that those guys can get their eyes locked back in on the target that they're trying to hit. Stand-ins, whether that's with the dummy or whether that's with the hitter tracking, and again, age appropriate would probably be the thing here, but having stand-ins, the more that visually it can look the way that it's supposed to look when you're throwing the pitch in the game, that's what we're after. And then even some small things like, breathing, like if that's something that you're employing, as a mental skill, and breathing is a piece of that, making sure that we're doing it in the bullpen so that we're practicing it so that when we get into the game, it's as real as we can get it. And then maybe, something like picks to a catcher, all you have to do is basically turn sideways on the mound and now your catcher becomes a first baseman and you may end the bullpen with a pick or two at first base, and just making sure that you're getting that work in. Time compressed whenever possible. That's really hard with pitching because there isn't any sort of time frame on a pitch. But I think time compressed when you can. 4 second plays, PFPs, and that's pretty important for your infielders. It's also pretty important for your pitcher. If you want guys to go full speed, put a watch on them. And that may not sound like a big deal, but that 4 second play, when he's trying to turn a double play, at second base, he's got to get to the ball fast. He's got to break down. He's got to make a good throw. And we got to try to turn that thing in 4 seconds. For you guys, it might be 5 seconds. I mean, whatever the normal speed of play that you play. But for us, it kind of be like a 4 second play. So we want to time compress that as much as we can. Something as simple as 15 seconds in between pitches. If that's important to you, if you, of pace of play and getting the ball and engaging with your infielders is an important piece for you, then time it, and get that 15 seconds, blow a horn when the 15 seconds happens. If he hasn't thrown the pitch yet, if nothing else, it's just a way for him to understand he's got to speed up his clock a little bit. And then we do a lot in spring training with smaller fields. I love smaller fields. I think, instead of the 90-foot bases, we'll do 75, sometimes even 60-foot bases. We do this thing called bull in the ring where you start the ball at home plate, you roll a comebacker or a cover or a bunt, and you're calling out a base. And he throws to that base. That base automatically becomes home plate. He's the bull in the ring, so the guy stays in that little compressed area. You're rolling him another ball, and you're telling him to go to another place. So your field is always shifting. So home base, if you throw to first base, now home would be third, if that makes sense. So your field's always shifting. It can be really, really fast. It's a great PFP drill, and it's a lot of fun. And I think that's, kind of why our guys seem to like it a good bit. And speaking of fun, like that's sort of our 10th rule, if you will. You just got to look for places for fun. Those 9 pocket targets that we were talking about, put clay pigeons that you shoot, for skeet or clay pigeon shooting. You can buy a bazillion of them for next to nothing. You can find little hooks that you can hook inside of the 9 pocket. And that's how you play your game. I've done some things like pitching Olympics, and where I've taken different pieces of like our throwing program and picks and PFPs, and I've even done like concentration squares, as a mental exercise. But going through like a pitching Olympics, and having again like kind of inter-team competition. Points and a reward at the end. Relay races for conditioning. I think those are cool. Tag for warm up. We've done talent shows, which are an immense amount of fun. And, you know, it's a team building thing too. Like guys get together and they sort of make fun of themselves. Free throws for conditioning, right? Like most schools, there's a hoop nearby. Okay, today we're shooting free throws for conditioning. Simple bets. One of the things that I heard a few years ago that I thought was pretty cool, Mark Spitz, who prior to, you know, the last few years was an Olympic champion, had the most Olympic medals, you know, until I can't remember his name, but the big guy, the good swimmer, overtook him. And Spitz talks about his time at Indiana with Doc Counsell, who was a legendary swimming coach at IU. And Spitz talks a lot about how the thing that drove him the most was that Counsell would give out jelly beans for good performances, and he wouldn't give them out easy or cheap, but like for him, it was a way of, you know, driving himself. So again, like, I just want to be able to add something to what you guys do and to help you and your players. This is a page out of the playbook that we use. I think I'm pretty close to being on the money in terms of time. So I guess we got questions coming up if you guys have any. Thanks again for having me.
Of course, DJ, great info. I mean, there's a lot of things in there that I know some coaches, a lot of the questions that I get, that we get are, well, you know, it's great that these professional coaches do this, but I coach 9-year-olds. Yeah, but you can have a relay race for conditioning instead of just making them run foul poles, right? I mean, there's all those little nuances that you can try to make it your own and blend with the big boys in down to the little guys and make it work for them, right? So I do want to ask you about constraints. I know you touched on, you know, using constraints and training. What are some things that you do, I mean, on the daily for constraints? I know there's stand-ins. You use strings a lot also or not?
Yeah, strings, colored plates. You know, usually when we're doing our primers, which is stuff that we're doing prior to throwing the ball, you know, we're doing a lot of the plyo care stuff. We're doing some water bag type of events in the weight room prior to coming out. You know, like a constraint is really just building in, you know, something that's holding back from the normal throw. So like being on two knees or being on one knee or having the wrong foot forward is a constraint. We have to be very, very individual with our guys, you know, based on what they need and based on maybe what we're working on. But really, like, you can come up with constraints from that end, really as many as you want. Like, you can create your own drills. And I think that's really, to me, the best drills are the drills that you are coming up with on your own, based on your needs and what your players need. But, you know, I think it kind of goes back to just, you know, the blending piece, you know, going back and forth between whatever drill that is, and that drill may be constrained, but then going in and actually pitching. I just think a lot of implicit learning happens when you're doing it that way. I think you're getting a better and faster result, which, you know, for us and really for anyone, if we can make someone better faster, we want to be able to do that.
Right. No doubt. You said implied learning. I mean, something that really just a light bulb moment for me in the last few years was a coach explaining, you know, we want to show them how to organize their body, because if you put them in a position to make their body organize itself, they can typically figure it out, right? Take my 6-year-old. She doesn't know how to hit. I throw the ball, the bat's in her hand. I throw her the ball, right? She learns how to swing the bat towards the ball. That's the reality of it. So if you can put them in positions to where they have to organize, their body has to organize itself for success, they're going to have a chance to do it. Cause not everyone can take what you say and just apply it. Right. I'm sure you have all sorts of different learners in the pit, in the, all of the pitching staffs at Cincinnati Reds. I'm sure there's visual learners. I'm sure there's auditory learners, that it all, you got to find the right way to reach each individual.
Sure. And really the external and the goal stuff is so much better, you know, really than a lot of the internal. You know, the internal is I've got to think my way through this movement, and your body really isn't designed to do that. It's like, do you ever have to think about walking? And really you don't, thankfully. You know, so really just having a really good
I've coached a few guys that may have.
Yeah, right.
I've coached a few guys that may have had to think about it.
Yeah, I guess looking back on it, I probably have too, but I think the big thing is looking at the goal, whatever that goal is, and being able to change the goal, which changes the experience of the movement, or the movement experience. So I think that's a really big piece of it. You know, is like, it's challenging. It's where the reaches come in a little bit too, that I talked about earlier. I think that's, you know, a pretty important piece of it.
Very good. C. Bassett asks, can you explain the positioning of the bull in the ring PFP? Can you talk through that a little bit?
Yeah, it's not nearly as hard as probably what I make it out to be. But essentially, just think about there being four bases and you have someone in the middle. He's the bull. He's the pitcher. And you're basically rolling him a bunt or a comeback, or, and you're calling out a base. 1-1-1, 2-2-2, 3-3-3, 4-4-4. And he's throwing to that base. Whatever base he throws to will then become home plate. So the orientation of your field will switch based on where you throw the ball. So if you throw the ball to first base, then first base becomes home, right? And it would work accordingly. So then second would be first. Third would be second, and home would be third. So you're just basically changing the orientation. You're moving it back and forth. And what you find is, like, you get guys that get screwed up. They call two, and they're disoriented. So it's really fast. It's a lot of fun. But it does make them learn how to kind of think on their feet. It makes them go quick. It changes sort of like the monotony of what PFP can become, you know, and if you're doing it right and it gets better and better and better, now all of a sudden you're bull in the ring for 15 seconds and it's a pretty good workout. You got a lot of footwork done. You're making that intermediate throw, which for me, guys have a really hard time with. You know, we throw really hard. And we're good at throwing really hard. We're not really good at throwing that short throw, you know, trying to flip it to your first baseman. You know, you see a lot of kind of yips start to happen because of that. So it's really just the orientation of the field changes all the time. And that's why you want it to be smaller too. So it's throw down bases in the outfield. It's really easy, 60 to 75 feet. You know, you've got a little league diamond and you're working that way. If you're a little league coach, you know, I don't know how close you could shrink it. But at the same time, I still think you could probably do some stuff with it.
That's great. It's a great idea. Final question here from Chris Kuzmich. Do you ever have your guys do, have you ever come across this in training, speed throwing, fast pitching to the catcher, back to you as quick as you can? Or is it more, we stop, take a breath, collect and go?
Yeah, I've seen it because I made a guy do it in the past. So, and I'm not sure my reasoning for do it with that particular young man was that I wanted him to stop thinking. And so this was a way for him to kind of like not have too much of an opportunity to think. Like part of mental skills in general are the idea of like training your thinking is a lot of times it's like not thinking or not overthinking. I mean, you look at high school guys, you look at college guys, and obviously some pro guys too, they do a lot of that. It's like, you know, it's bad thinking. So this was a way for me to kind of get him out of his own way, you know, and it was like a cardio pen almost. And I liked it.
Got
it. And it worked, but you know, I haven't seen it for any other use. I'm not exactly sure what it would be used for, but I'd be all ears. I mean, it sounds interesting. But that's how I used it.
Very good. All right. One final question before we let you go. Who has the better fungo, Michael Curly Neal or Bobby Simpson?
I'm going to have to go toss up there.
We need you on record.
Okay. I'm going to give the edge to Coach Neal. He's a pretty good fungo guy.
Okay.
He's a pretty good fungo guy.
We'll put that feather in his hat. That's fine. Very good. Hey, Derek Johnson, DJ, appreciate you making time for us. I know you're a busy man through many roles and titles, but thank you for making time for our coaches tonight.
Thanks again for having me, and good luck, guys.
Absolutely. All right, whether you joined us on the actual Zoom getting credit for USA Baseball coaching certification, or if you're one of the thousands of people that joined us on Facebook, or you're watching this 6 months from now on our YouTube channel, thank you for showing up tonight and getting better with these tremendous presenters that we had for USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 62. We'll see you in 2 weeks. We'll get you another great speaker lineup here. My name is Andrew Bartman, the Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Never be someone's last coach. Provide a great experience for those kids, and we will see you here in a couple of weeks. Thank you very much.